Morning students. Right, so in this session we will see the problems on journal bearing design. Design a journal bearing for a centrifugal pump from the following data. Calculate also the mass of the lubricating oil required for artificial cooling. If rise of temperature of oil be limited to 10 degrees centigrade. Okay. So the load on the journal W is equal to 20,000 newtons. So load on the journal is given, and the notation for this already we have considered W, right? It is not specified in the problem, right? Just for our simplicity, I have given W here. Speed of the journal N is equal to 900 rpm. Type of lubricating oil is SAE10, whose absolute viscosity Z is equal to 0.017 kg per meter second, right? And this viscosity is at 55 degrees centigrade. That means this 55 degrees centigrade is the bearing temperature, that is equal to operating temperature of the bearing. Okay. Then ambient temperature, TA, is equal to 15.5 degrees centigrade. Then maximum bearing pressure is given, PB maximum, 1.5 newton per mm square. Heat dissipation coefficient C is given, 1232 watt per meter square per degree centigrade. So this is the data given to you, and now you are asked to design a journal bearing. Apart from this design, you are also asked to find out mass of the lubricating oil required for artificial cooling. That means the bearing is not under complete thermal equilibrium, and if it is not in the thermal equilibrium, some amount of extra heat is generated compared with the capacity of heat dissipation, and this extra heat generated must be dissipated by some other means, that is by artificial cooling, right? So for this artificial cooling, either you need to use water or other coolant oil. So you are asked to find out mass of the coolant oil required to provide the artificial cooling if the temperature of temperature rise is limited to 10 degrees centigrade. Okay. So what is the first step in the design process here? First step in the design process, determination of bearing length. Determination of bearing length. See the design procedure for this given centrifugal pump bearing, right? Given that the bearing is for the centrifugal pump. Bearing is for the centrifugal pump. Centrifugal pump bearing. First, look at the data related to this centrifugal pump bearing. Okay, so which is right? Look at page number for centrifugal pump bearing. Look at different data related to this design of centrifugal pump bearing in the page number. Refer page number 19.14 of General Clean Design Data Handbook. Okay, so the first column of first row of this table has given different values, different types of data related to centrifugal pump bearing, right? So allowable bearing pressure, absolute viscosity of lubricant, operating values of Zn by P, C by D, and L by D ratio, right? So first step in the design process, determine the length of the bearing. determine the length of the bearing. Okay. So to determine the length of the bearing, first let us assume that, let us take diameter of journal. Diameter of journal D is equal to 100 millimeters, right? From data book, take L by D ratio. Take L by D is equal to, yesterday I think we have taken 1.6, since L by D ratio ranging from 1 to 2. It is ranging from 1 to 2. Okay. So it implies L is equal to 1.6 into D. That is equal to 160 millimeters. That is equal to 160 millimeters.
Hello? Sir? Sir?
Okay. Now we got the length of the bearing. Now you have to check whether these two proportions, dimensional proportions, are correct as far as the bearing pressure is concerned. Then the next second step, determine the bearing pressure. Therefore, bearing pressure, PB is equal to bearing load divided by projected area. Projected area is equal to L into D. So that is equal to, what is W value? 20,000 newtons divided by 160 into 100. Right? So 3 zeros cancel with 3 zeros here. 20 by 60, I think you will get 1.25. What are the units here? Numerator is newtons, denominator millimeter, and millimeter, you will get a millimeter square. Okay. Now you check whether this bearing pressure is within the maximum allowable bearing pressure. But the PB maximum is given. It is less than PB maximum. What is PB maximum value? It is given in our problem, that is equal to 1.5 newton per mm square. 1.5 newton per mm square. Therefore, design of bearing is said right. Therefore, L is 160 mm. Diameter D is 100 mm. Give the same bearing pressure. Here onwards, length of the bearing is L is equal to 160, diameter is equal to 100 mm. Okay, then what is the next step, third step? Selection of lubricant. But here, the properties related to the lubricant already given. So, lubricant is SAE 10, and whose absolute viscosity is given, that is equal to 0.017 kg per meter second. Right? Even if you convert this into Newton second per meter square, you will get the same value. Okay? And the operating temperature, T naught is given. T naught is equal to 55 degrees centigrade. The operating temperature of the lubricating oil is 55 degrees centigrade. This is given. Okay. Then the fourth step in the design process is bearing characteristic number. Determination of the operating value of bearing characteristic number. Okay. Right? So, operating value. Value of Zn by P. Right? Calculate this. 0.017 into RPM is 900 RPM and P is 1.25 Newton per mm square. How much you will get? I think you will get this 12.24. 12. What are the units here? Bearing characteristic number is?
Sir, 11.95, sir.
So, no units at all.
Now, sir, 11.95, achin, sir.
Whether this operating value is above the bearing modulus, right? So, standard Zn by P value per centrifugal pump bearing are minimum Zn by P value per centrifugal pump bearing. Or you can take bearing characteristic number is equal to, look at the data book page number 19.14 of Jalaluddin, right? Operating value, so Zn by P minimum, right? It is given VCM is equal to 28.45. Here I am giving the page number. Page number 19.14 of Jalaluddin Design Data Handbook. Okay, so now this is bearing characteristic number. For normal loading, bearing characteristic number for normal loading. BCM or bearing characteristic number generally considered as 3 times bearing modulus. 3 times. What is K here? Bearing modulus, or you can write 3 into bearing modulus. The symbol used to denote this bearing modulus is K. Okay, therefore, what is BCM value here? BCM is 28.45 is equal to 3K. From this, you can get the value of K, bearing modulus value. How much you will get? 28.45 divided by 3. How much? I think 9 point something. You will get 9.45. What is the unit? This also bearing modulus is a bearing characteristic number, so it is a dimensionless number. Now you have to compare this operating value of 12.24 with bearing modulus, right? So from our graph PP, coefficient of friction and Zn by P value. This is mu and this is Zn by P. Right? You will have the graph like this. Right? So, this is the portion of a stable working condition for hydrodynamic general bearing. So, this is hydrodynamic condition. Right? And this is K. Right? If your Zn by P value, operating value of Zn by P is greater than K, then it falls in the region of hydrodynamic lubrication. That's what we have discussed in our earlier sessions. Therefore, Zn by P operating value, I'm taking Zn by P suffix O. What is the suffix O indicates here? Suffix O indicates the operating value of Zn by P is equal to 12.24, which is greater than bearing modulus k, that is equal to 9.45, implies right. From this, we can conclude that bearing operates under hydrodynamic conditions. Therefore, we can say that bearing operates under hydrodynamic conditions. Okay, I hope it is clear. First, you find out the values of L and D, and you check whether these L and D values are correct as far as the design of the bearing is concerned by taking bearing pressure as a parameter to check this and lubricating oil properties, then operating value of Zn by P. Okay, then next step here, determination of coefficient of friction. Determination of coefficient of friction. You know the empirical relations to find out the coefficient of friction, right? Right? You know the formula to find out this coefficient of friction. Mu is equal to 33 by 10 to the power of 8 into Zn by P into V by C plus small p, right? So this is the coefficient of friction equation. So when Z is in SI units, Newton second per meter square or kg per meter second. Now you know the value of Zn by P here. That's equal to, just substitute the values here, 33 by 10 power of 8 into, what is Zn by P operating value? 12.24 into D by C value. You select it from data book, right? C by D is given in the data book. C by D is how much? It is 0.0013. So 1 by 0.0013, right? Plus K is end leakage factor, depends on L by D ratio. So for, since the bearing is a long bearing, plus K is equal to, this value is always equal to 0.002, and this value you can take it from design data handbook. Okay, so this is equal to 0.002, right? So D by C, you take from page number same, table 19.14 of Jalaluddin data book. Okay, C by D is 0.0013, but here it is the D by C. Now you calculate this value. Tell me what is the value of this. We will get some value for this coefficient of friction. Then sixth step is determination of heat generation. Since there is this certain amount of friction between general and the bearing, obviously the heat is generated. Heat generated, Hg is equal to, you know the formula, mu into W into V. Mu into W into V. So, anybody got the value of mu? Mu is the heat generated, mu WV, mu is 0.05, and W is 20,000 newtons, and
velocity is rubbing velocity pi d n by 60, right? Can anybody calculate the value? Later you find out heat dissipated. This is amount of heat generation, right? So 471 kilowatts. Now heat dissipated. What is the heat dissipated formula? HD is equal to CA into TB minus TA. TB minus TA. Right? So here the bearing temperature is not given, right? Bearing temperature is not given, but TB minus TA can be expressed in terms of operating temperature, half into T naught minus TA. TB minus TA is equal to half into T naught minus TA. So here operating temperature it is given 55 degrees centigrade, right? Minus ambient temperature, I think 15.5 degrees centigrade. Okay, so half into 55 minus 15.5, how much you will get? Right. Therefore, C value it is given 1232 watt per meter square per degree centigrade into area. The heat dissipation is also calculated based on the projected area, L into D. Or you can write this C into area is L into D into half into T naught minus TA. So that is equal to 1232 into 160 into 100 into 19.75. 55 minus 15.5, is it okay? 39.5 by 2, 17.5. Now tell me the value you will get in terms of watts. So here this is in terms of meter square, right? But this is in meters. So you convert this also into meters, right? Millimeter square, 10 to the power of minus 6 you will get here, right? Here also earlier we have, we need to take the diameter in terms of meters. So you will get 10 to the power of minus 3. Obviously you will get, just correct this value, 471.238 watts, right? Now here you tell me the value.
Right.
Three eight nine 0.312 sir. Watts. Right? Here this is 471, here it is 389. Now, what is the next step in the design process? You consider the thermal equilibrium, right? So the bearing is said to be under thermal equilibrium. If the total heat generated is equal to total heat dissipated, right? But here in this problem, heat generated is greater than heat dissipated. Heat generated is 471 point something, heat dissipated is 389. Therefore, amount of artificial cooling required. Required is equal to H is equal to Hg minus Hd. Hg is 471.23. Minus Hd is 389.31. Okay, now tell me what is this 471 minus 389? We'll get 81.926 watts. Okay, so this is the amount of artificial cooling required, right? So now you need to find out the mass of the coolant oil or the lubricating oil required to dissipate this heat artificially, right? Next, ninth step in the design, mass of the lubricating oil required. Mass of the lubricating oil or you can write a coolant required is calculated by considering artificial cooling. H is equal to mass of the coolant oil required into specific heat of this coolant or lubricating oil into delta T into MST. So this equation you can use here to find out mass of the lubricating oil required. So M is unknown, S is the specific heat of lubricating oil, and temperature rise. So due to this extra amount of heat generation, the temperature of this lubricating oil is slightly increased, and it is limited to 10 degrees centigrade. Look at this equation. So 19.13, equation number 19.13, M is equal to, so here it is given, Cp is the specific heat of oil, specific heat of oil. So Cp is given here, right? Therefore, 81.926 is equal to M is unknown here. You take S value from the data book, right? Equation number, page number 19.3. Page number 19.3, right? I think it is not visible here. Page number 19.3, right? Let us take S is equal to. So it is ranging from 1840 joule per kg per degree centigrade to 2100. Let us take 2000 kg per, sorry, joule per kg per degree centigrade. You take this value from the data book. Okay. Take S is equal to 2000. Then 2000 joule per kg per degree centigrade into how many degrees? 10 degrees centigrade. Now you will get the value of m. What is the unit of m here? You will get m in terms of kgs. Right? So per second, kg per second. Now you can convert this into 0.0048 into 60. You will get kg per minute. How much it is? 288 kg per minute. Okay. So that's how you can find out the mass of the lubricating oil or the coolant oil required in case the thermal equilibrium is not attained for the bearing. Okay, so these 9 are the steps in the design procedure of journal bearing. Okay, first determine the length of the bearing, then check whether the selected value of length and the diameters are correct as far as the design is concerned by taking bearing pressure as the limiting condition. Then third one, lubricating oil properties. Then fourth one is bearing characteristic number selection. Then as usual, by using empirical relations, you can find out coefficient of friction, heat generated, heat dissipated. Then if it is under thermal equilibrium, no need to go for the 8th and 9th step. If it is not in thermal equilibrium, then obviously you need to go for artificial cooling by some means. And when you consider artificial cooling, you need to find out the mass of the coolant oil required to dissipate the entire heat generated. Okay, is it clear? Right, thank you.